Good morning, everyone. So I'm Marcus, and this talk is going to be about a novel method for analyzing the detector output Z of t for any quantum measurement. But here we are going to explicitly look at quantum transport measurements. I'm going to present to you the theory that we, the group of Daniel Hegele, developed that is able to bridge the gap between any detector output, Z of t from a quantum measurement and the description of the underlying system, for example, the stochastic master equation, without any compromises. We are going to do this by using so-called Pauli spectra or higher order spectra that can be calculated directly from the measurement and so really directly from your measurement, your detector will spit out. These can then be fitted to their theoretical counterpart to characterize the system. Here, in case of transport measurements, this means determining the tunneling rates of an electron into and from the dot. In case of quantum transport measurements, this technique leads to the very same results as the Foucaulting statistics, but does so, in fact, completely automatically. No need for defining thresholds, no need to do manual analysis, just plug in the expected Hamiltonian, damping operators, enter operator you are measuring, and that's it. Sounds too good to be true? Bear with me, and you will be learning about the future of quantum data analysis. We also wrote a paper about everything I'm going to talk about today, and it's already on archive and waiting to be published in a journal. Since the system of interest are quantum dots, I'm firstly going to introduce the system and show you a few example measurements. After defining the analysis problem, we will leave the quantum world shortly and try to gain an intuitive understanding of Pauli spectra and afterwards define them properly. Next, I'm going to introduce the stochastic master equation, and we will come to the most difficult part of the talk, which is calculating the Pauli spectra directly from the stochastic master equation. Lastly, we will be analyzing the real-world transport measurements and compare them to traditional methods like the Foucaulting statistics. So one of the most common quantum dot implementation are gate-defined quantum dots or single electron transistors. Here, the quantum dot is defined by depleting a two-dimensional electron gas via negatively charged electrodes, here shown in yellow. This allows for the creation of tunneling barriers to the source and drain electrodes. The quantum dot in the region of the dotted white line is then operated close to the charge degeneracy point in the Coulomb blockade regime, where only one electron at a time can enter from the source electrode and leave through the drain electrode. While the stream of electrons is driven through the quantum dot, a separate current is passed through the quantum point contact, short QPC, at the top of the image, whose conductance is highly sensitive to the presence of an extra electron in the dot. And by monitoring the switches of the current in real time, we can watch the electrons tunneling through the left and right barriers. On the right-hand side, you can see what a typical measurement looks like. It's the black curve. And in red and blue, there are shown the number of electrons possibly tunneled at a certain times. So the self-assembled quantum dots used in our paper can be described in a similar way. However, the measurement is performed optically. To measure whether one of the dots is now charged or not, because there are many dots in one layer, a laser is focused on one of the dots and tuned to a frequency of an exciton transition. This means that the laser can generate electron hole pairs within the dot, which quickly annihilate again, sending out a photon called the resonance fluorescent signal, which can be captured by fast photodetectors. The key is that the frequency of the exciton transition will be shifted as soon as an electron enters the dot and the photodetector will stop clicking. The measurements look like telegraph switching, exactly like the ones before. You can see them in the inset here. I'm also going, also showing you the power spectra for different tunneling rates. These are directly calculated from these traces. Of course, these traces are much longer than shown in this inset. You can see that although these are very three very distinct situations, for example, in case A, the dot is almost always empty, the spectra look quite similar and will be in fact not sufficient to extract the tunneling rates. This is the reason we move to higher order spectra, or one of the reasons. Now, if the laser intensity is high, this measurement is called a strong measurement because it forces the dot to reveal if it's full or empty. In other words, the measurement collapses the wave function and the system has to decide for one of its eigenstates. As a consequence, any coherent behavior will be suppressed and our measurement will contain quantum jumps. If we now want to characterize the system, we have to extract the tunneling rates gamma in and gamma out called from now on. You can see such a simulated trace for a strong measurement here. In dark blue, the expectation value as given by the density matrix of the system is shown, and it's switching between 0 and 1, so between an empty and full dot. However, this is not what a detector would give you. The detector trace is shown in light blue, and it is always accompanied by noise. We will see why later. In case of such a strong measurement, it is easy to do the analysis since we can define thresholds above which we can say, okay, now the dot is full or now the dot is empty. This is at the heart of the full counting statistics. And after plotting the histogram of the number of times the dot was charged or discharged for a certain period, we can do an exponential fit to extract the tunneling rates. However, there are a few downsides to this method. One, these thresholds cannot always be defined that easily, affect the outcome of the analysis, and might neglect or overemphasize so-called spikes in the measurement, where we really cannot be sure if an electron has left the dot or not. And second, as you might have guessed, there are not only strong measurements, but also weak measurements. For example, the laser power could be decreased to a point where the system is only seldom being disturbed, and hence coherent evolution can still take place. Then, of course, there will be no quantum jumps, and the trace will be predominantly white noise. This trace would look completely random at first glance, as you can see here. However, it is still containing all the information of the tunneling rates, and maybe even more since coherent evolution is still allowed. The problem is now that the noise power increases inversely squared with the decrease of measurement strength, and we are left with the question of how could we possibly analyze such a trace. Now that we have defined the problem, we can start gaining an intuitive understanding of polyspectra. And this is most easily done in the intuitive classical world. But I'm actually not talking about Newtonian classical physics. I'm talking about the musical kind of classical physics. Because as it turns out, the human comes pre-equipped with a pretty good measurement device, which can even generate spectrograms. And of course, I'm talking about your ears, and you will need them soon. So with your device ready, I have a quick challenge for you. I sat down in front of the piano and recorded two different melodies for you, each containing three notes. In the first recording, I will be playing the notes separately, and in the second recording, I will be playing them all simultaneously. Afterwards, I will ask you to match the recording to the corresponding spectra, which I will be showing on the screen. I will be displaying the usual power spectrum, also called the S2, because it's a second order spectrum. And one of the higher order spectra, the trispectrum, or also called the S4. The hints you will get are that the S2, the power spectrum, shows the intensity of power at different frequencies, And the S4, on the other hand, is two-dimensional and shows contribution only if the intensities of the signal at omega 1 and omega 2 are correlated. It will then be shown in red, or anti-correlated, then it will be shown in blue. Hence, I will also refer to the S4 as correlation spectrum. We will get to the third order later. So here are the two recordings, and in the top and bottom row, I will reveal the spectra of each recording. You will have to find out which row belongs to which recording, so let's listen to them. Here's the first recording. Okay, so here's the second one. And here are the corresponding spectra. The corresponding power spectra. What do you think? Which one belongs to which recording? Okay. Here's the next spectrum. And this is the S4, or the tri-spectrum. Again, I'm going to give you a second to think about it. So for those of you who were able to do it, congratulations. For the other ones who just want to enjoy the show, here's the solution. In both cases, the power spectrum wasn't much of a help. You can see the contributions of all three frequencies, but since they appear in both recordings, it is not enough to decide for the correct correspondence. Clear differences, however, can be seen in the S4. In case of a single note, the notes are anti-correlated. When one note is present, the other one definitely aren't. So these are the blue anti-correlated dots over here. In the second recording, the notes are positively correlated since all are played and not played at the same time. Right now, I'm also showing you the S3 in the middle, called the bispectrum, which shows a contribution only if two frequencies, omega 1 and omega 2, are phase correlated with the sum of their frequencies. Hence, it's a bit more difficult to interpret. But this means that with the S3, you could measure the phase between the root and the higher harmonics of a piano signal, for example. As an example from the quantum realm, here you can see a correlation spectrum of a 9.5 electron spin coupled to an outside magnetic field and the nuclear spin. Here, the direction of the spin is measured weakly by a continuous probe laser beam. And if the measurement Z of T now reveals some of the spectral weight at one of the 10 peak frequencies, the system also reveals some information about its total angular momentum. Remember, before the measurement, the electron spin could have been in a superposition of all of its eigenstates, visible in the power spectrum in the middle. Z of T mostly contains spectral weight at frequencies that are compatible with the total angular momentum. Hence, here shown for the 100 millitesla case, the positive correlations in the S4 appear among spectral lines that are close in frequency. Now that you have a somewhat intuitive feel for the spectra, I will go on showing you how these spectra are theoretically defined and what their properties are. Here you can see the definition of the power spectrum. Later, we will be generalizing this definition to higher orders. The power spectrum is defined as a Fourier transformation of the two-point autocorrelation function of our signal, Z of T. Now, you might be wondering, why did he say two-point correlation function when there is only one variable in the correlation function A? The reason for this is that the signal must be stationary for all the coming formulas to hold. And the stationarity implies that it does not matter when we compare two points of the signal with each other, only the time differences between the points play a role. To calculate the autocorrelation function, we use the second order cumulant of the signal and the shifted signal you can see on the right-hand side. Now I bet There are three kinds of people in the audience. The first kind know cumulants and say, great, he uses cumulants. The second kind have seen cumulants already, but would ask, why is he using cumulants instead of moments? And the third kind wonders, what the heck are cumulants? I'm going to take care of group number two first, and on the next slide, we will take care of group number three. So first, the cumulants have a very important property of linearity. This means that the cumulants of two independent measurements, x and y, is the sum of the cumulants of each measurement. This allows us to subtract any background contribution from the measurement. The second reason is the fact that cumulants of order n do not contain any information that is already given by the cumulant of order n minus 1. So for example, the C2 in the autocorrelation function, we are already subtracting the means from the signal because they are already contained in the C1. This, could you please turn off your microphone? There's somebody with microphone on. This has the nice effect of removing delta functions due to a constant mean value at omega equals zero. So since we are working with cumulants up to order 4, I want to show you how they are calculated. This is most easily understood when we compare the cumulants with the moments. So the first moment and first cumulants are both only just the means of the values. The first differences arise in the second order, where the cumulants would give you the variance of the variance if x would equal to y instead of only the mean square. For the third order, I just wanted to note that the number of terms of cumulants are growing quickly, the terms in the cumulants. And for the fourth order, we already are dealing with 15 terms. Now for the generalization to the higher order spectra, we can make use of a definition made by Brillinger in 1965 and say that the cumulant of order n of the Fourier transform of our signal will give you the spectrum of order n times the delta function. We do not have to worry about this delta function since it is being taken care of by the window function, which we have to apply to finite measurement traces. This is what the expression would look like for the power spectrum. And we can also see that while the usual power spectrum is one-dimensional, the bispectrum, or the S3, is two-dimensional, and the trispectrum is three-dimensional. However, for the rest of the talk and in the paper, we only use the cut through the S4 by setting omega 3 equal to minus omega 1. This will be enough to characterize our systems. Now, if I would be given this telegraph noise measurement, how would I go about calculating the spectrum? First of all, we have to cut the trace into multiple frames of equal length t. Each of the frames consists of discrete points Zj. And before applying the discrete Fourier transform, the frames have to be multiplied by a window function, favorably the confined Gaussian window for the optimal time bandwidth product. Now we have the Fourier coefficients A of k and need to plug them into the cumulant estimators as developed at our share. You might know the estimator for the variance and recognize the Bessel factor m over m minus 1. Hence, we now have to decide for a value of m, and here we are using 5, for example, and therefore are calculating 3 separate spectra. This allows us to be able to estimate the error of each point of the spectrum later. A similar factor can be found for the higher orders, here the C3, and for the fourth order, you can see that there's an m minus 3 in the prefactor, and this is why we have to use at least 4 frames to calculate one spectra, one trispectra. So after the cumulant expression, the last thing we have to do is convert the cumulants to spectra, since this conversion depends on the chosen window function G and your sampling rate. You can see that now we actually took the mean of the three cumulants we calculated before, and to estimate the error, you could now calculate the variance of the three spectra. Now we are ready to discuss the important properties of the spectra. What do they tell us about the signal? Firstly, I already said that in order for these estimators to work, the signal needs to be stationary. In case of the piano recording, this was actually almost not the case. The modes on the piano are quite long-lived, and if the coherence time is much longer than the length of the frames used for the discrete Fourier transform, the frames are not independent of each other, and hence the signal is not stationary. For the S2, there is a partial solution to this problem by using a second moment instead of the second cumulant. However, you would then have to deal with the delta function at omega equals zero. The next important thing is that the higher order spectra can be imaginary. For example, the S3, if time reversal symmetry is broken. So if you could decide whether a signal is being played back forwards or backwards, the bispectrum will have significant imaginary contributions. The cut through the S4, however, will always be real. The third and most important property is the fact that only the S2 is affected by white noise. And when you think about it, this is quite a remarkable fact, since we now have a tool to determine whether a noisy signal contains any information or not. And since we are still trying to build an intuition for classical signals, I was trying to think about an example for a signal which was almost only noise, but might have some hidden information. And I'm going to show you something I bet even economic students have never seen. We are going to analyze stock prices with polyspectra. I mean, if we could find some hidden correlations, we might be able to stop writing proposals and let a sophisticated algorithm do its thing. Of course, we are expecting mostly Gaussian behavior, and we are going to analyze the two companies that made this work possible, and that is Apple and AMD. Apple, because I've written all the code on a MacBook, and AMD, because I use their graphics cards for the calculations. In case you want to build your own higher order spectrum analyzer, I would highly suggest using graphics cards together with a high-level library such as ArrayFire, since all of the calculations can be written as matrix multiplications, and especially the S4 can take quite a while to calculate when you are dealing with multiple gigabytes of data. We are going to use the last 2 years of adjusted close price data by the minute to calculate the spectra, and since we are dealing with long time frames, here are the conversions between minutes, hours, and days into hertz. So minutes lie in the order of tens of millihertz and days in the order of tens of microhertz. So here are the spectra for Apple. And the first thing you notice is that there is not much going on, maybe except for around omega equals zero, so in the order of days. To get a better view of the data points, I'm going to scale them with an area hyperbolic sine function, similar to a logarithmic function, but also working for negative values. Okay, so now we can see a little bit more. And you can see that in the power spectrum, there are actually more than one line. The blue line is the actual value, and the gray lines are the error bands with a width of 1 to 5 sigma. This means that here the course of the power spectrum really is significant. On the other hand, the bispectrum seems to be pretty random, and the S4 is maybe almost always positively correlated. Now, in order to show you which of the points of the higher order spectra are at least 3 sigma significant, I'm going to color each point that is not at least 3 sigma significant green. Are you ready? Ah, what a shame. Almost all points are green. So almost nothing is significant. Okay, this was Apple. Maybe we have more luck with AMD. But no, unfortunately not. This means Maybe there is no hidden information inside stock prices, and day trading could be a waste of time. And we are basically stuck writing proposals. So let's go on. Maybe we have more luck in the quantum world. The first goal is to model the detector output of quantum transport measurements as seen in this plot here. When thinking about the evolution of a quantum system, the first equation that comes to your mind is, of course, the Schrödinger equation. However, there are a few reasons why this equation is not sufficient to simulate such a trace. Number one, the Schrödinger equation does not include damping. However, this is needed to simulate coupling to the environment efficiently or model incoherent tunneling in our case. Additionally, the measurement can only be modeled as a projection and no detector output is given. The next improvement from the Schrödinger equation is the Lindblad equation. This equation now works with density matrices instead of state vectors and can model incoherent dynamics. However, it is still gives no equation for the detector output and therefore is not sufficient. The only way to also model the detector is by using the stochastic master equation. And these are actually two equations, one for the state evolution and one for the detector output. Where the measurement is now modeled by weak interaction that can also be increased to a point where the trace would look like a strong projective measurements, as shown here on the right side. So how can we think about weak measurements? Let's say we want to weakly measure the Z of orientation of a yellow spin contained in a more complex quantum system. We are actually going to divide the measurements into two parts. Instead of directly sending the yellow spin through the Stern-Gerlach experiment and projecting it, we are building a detector from a stream of probe spins, each prepared to point in alternating y directions and interacting coherently with the complex quantum system. Now, depending on the z direction of the probe spin, depending on the z direction of our yellow spin, the probe spins are partially rotated, which affect the probability of measuring up or down slightly. Hence, after projecting the probe spin, we gain partial information about the orientation of the yellow spin. And since this projective measurement will be accompanied by the randomness of the projection, the detector output will contain a lot of Gaussian noise and the expectation value of the Z orientation of the yellow spin, luckily. One thing to note is that during the time of interaction, the yellow spin and probe spin become entangled. And this leads to a small back action on the yellow spin, rotating it towards the measured state. So what does the stochastic master equation look like? It consists of multiple terms that I'm going to introduce step by step. So the first part is also known as the von Neumann equation and is responsible for the coherent evolution of the density matrix. The next term corresponds to the damping terms. Here I'm presenting the stochastic master equation for the quantum dot system with incoherent tunnelings, and these are the damping terms for charging and discharging the dots. Here the terms are proportional to the tunneling rates gamma in and gamma out, and this calligraphic D is also called a superoperator because it operates on a density matrix which already is an operator. It takes in an argument for the charging. This is the creation operator, a dagger. It creates an electron in the dot. And for the discharge, the annihilation operator is used. Next, we need terms which correspond to the measurement of the number operator n. Here it's for an general operator A. And these are actually two terms. The first term is damping due to the measurement. And you can see that it scales with the measurement strength beta squared. So the measurement strength will always be called beta in this talk. The second term takes care of the measurement back action because, as I said, even when we are measuring weakly, the outcome of the measurement affects the state of the system. but it does so stochastically. And this is exactly why this isn't proportional to the time dt, but to a normally distributed random variable dw. This causes the quantum noise. As said before, there's a second equation which takes care of the detector output z of t. Here we again find the measurement strength beta and the expectation value of the measurement operator. Additionally, there is the gamma, which is in fact the integral of the exact Wiener process which was used to integrate the upper equation. Because of the squared beta, the first term becomes much smaller than the noise for low measurement strengths below one. Let me just rearrange this equation a little bit, and I'm going to collect all the terms except for the stochastic back action in one term, and this is called the Liouvillean of a system. Okay, now let's have a look at a few solutions to this equation. For the case that beta is much larger than the tunneling rates, we get telegraph-like switching, as many of you are familiar with. However, for beta much smaller than gamma, we get a trace which is dominated by white noise. And again, the detector output is even noisier. Yes. So how do we go from stochastic master equation to Pauli spectra? We have to do two things. First, we have to calculate the moments, and we are going to use these moments to build the cumulants as we did before. In these formulas, these formulas for the moments beyond the second order are known since 2018, and they are actually quite intuitive. So let's start with the mean. Besides the measuring strength and the measurement operator, which we both have because we defined it, we need one more thing, that is the steady state of the system, rho zero. How do we get this state? We take the Liouvillean and diagonalize it and find that there will be only one eigenvector with the eigenvalue zero. Hence, this state is not decaying and therefore is the steady state. Now it's only one matrix multiplication and we will get the mean. The second moment looks quite similar, except we now have to compare the trace at two different points, T1 and T2. And this is exactly what we do here. The steady state is measured once by the operator A, so you have to think about it from the right to the left, just like matrix multiplications. So it's measured once by A, and then we let it evolve by applying the propagator G, which is the matrix exponential of the Liouvillean. And then we measure again with A. Don't worry about the calligraphic A here. It's basically the same as A. More information about it in the paper. Now, knowing that the second order works like this, the third order is not so difficult. And I also wanted to note that these are exact expressions from the SME, the stochastic master equation, and no approximations. Having the moments now ready, we could build the cumulants. But as I said before, the C4 would have 15 terms. And this is a problem since these superoperators might look small on paper, but they can be in fact huge matrices. Luckily, we found a way to minimize the number of terms by modifying the propagator and measurement operator. And this may seem like a small step, but it's actually super important since only now fast fitting routines can be implemented. So with these modifications, we can rewrite the C3, so the cumulant, in very compact form, which looks quite the same as the formula for the third moment. And this is the formula for the C2. There's a delta function which will take care of the constant offset in the power spectrum due to white noise after Fourier transformation. And the C4 now consists of 3 terms, which is definitely better than 15 terms. Now the Pauli spectra are only a multidimensional Fourier transform away. And before I show you the spectra, I quickly wanted to note or show you how these quantum Pauli spectra, power spectra, remember it was defined this way, was calculated up until the derivation of the new formulas. So it was simply stated by Landau in 1959 that one has to use a moment-like expression for the autocorrelation function. In the Heisenberg picture, this means multiplying the measurement operator A at different times. And since the measurement operators do generally not commute, he adds the expression again, but with mirror times. However, this correlator has multiple downsides. The time symmetry does not always hold between positive and negative tau, so time differences. Then the correlator also diverges for negative times in case of damping. And as you can see here, you would have to integrate from minus infinity. And the correlator is not cumulant-like, so it misses all the nice properties. Our correlator, on the other hand, is also valid for damping. The time symmetry always holds, and it's cumulant-like. For this comparison, we use the Heisenberg picture, but we are going to switch back to the Schrödinger picture, since for the higher order correlators, it is actually not known whether they can be written in the Heisenberg way. So here's the power spectrum derived from the stochastic master equation that corresponds to the quantum dot system. It is a Lorentzian with width of gamma in plus gamma out and a constant offset due to white noise. And what do the power spectra of the measurement look like? These are also, in fact, Lorentzians. Here you can see three different traces for three different tunneling rates. In case A, the output tunneling rate is much greater than gamma in. Hence, the dot is almost always empty all of the time. And case B and C are showing different combinations of tunneling rates. As with the piano example, the power spectrum is not sufficient to extract the tunneling rates. You can only determine their sum by determining the width of the Lorentzian. So now let's have a look at the higher order spectra and see if they can deliver the information needed. And lo and behold, the Bayes spectrum gives us exactly the missing piece of the puzzle, and that even on first sight, because the sign of the Bayes spectrum immediately reveals which of the tunneling parameters is larger. It is positive for gamma in, smaller than gamma out, and negative for the other case. On the right-hand side, you can see a comparison between the spectra calculated from the SME on the lower row and a spectrum calculated directly from the measurement outputs. As you can see, after fitting the analytical expression for the S2 and S3, which is shown here, the spectra almost match perfectly. There's no scaling, additional scaling needed. The fit then, of course, directly spits out the tunneling parameters. There's even an analytical formula for the S3, which of course makes the fit super, super quick. We did the same procedure together with the S4 and found that including the S4 improves the fit, since the tri-spectrum is highly sensitive on differences of the tunneling rates squared. You can see that it differs in shape quite a lot for different tunneling parameters. There is also an analytical form for the tri-spectrum of telegraph noise, but I'm only going to show it to you very quickly because I don't want to scare anyone. So good luck copying this monster into Python, and let's get away with it. Of course, after fitting, we compared the results to the traditional methods of electron counting and evaluating the waiting time distribution. These values are shown here as empty squares and triangles. Our extracted values are shown in red and blue, and most of the values match quite nicely, maybe except for the ones here around 0.39 millivolts. However, it turned out that the tunneling rate was not stable during the whole measurement time. Now we come to the situation of weak measurements. Weak measurements have already been realized, for example, by Kung in the Enslin group, as you can see here. By reducing the current through the quantum point contact, the measurement becomes less and less invasive and therefore weaker. But for our paper, we use the simulated data to see if the fit still works. And indeed, it does. Of course, the spectra a little bit more noisy, but depending on your measurement time, you can still fairly easily extract the tunneling rates. Here we used half an hour of this kind of noisy measurement, and again, the analytical fit matches almost perfectly with no additional scaling. The last thing I wanted to show that this also works for a more complicated transport system. Up until now, we have neglected spin relaxation, and we now want to include this also. In this case, there are 5 rates we have to cover to fully characterize the system. And the system now has 3 levels in total, because the electron can be either in spin up or spin down within the dot. The stochastic master equation now has more damping terms, 1 for each rate. And the measurement operator now is the sum of the number operator in the upper and to the lower state, since the electron can be in either of those. The measurement operator can then also be found in the equation for the detector output. And the spectra can look a little different from the ones of simple telegraph noise. And again, via fit of the Polyv spectra, we have extracted spin relaxation times for different magnetic fields. So to sum up the talk, the quantum Polyv spectra are a viable alternative to traditional electron counting methods for the characterization of quantum transport measurements and more. The approach works both for coherent and incoherent tunneling. It works in the strong and weak measurement regime, and it might also have applications in other fields of physics, like, for example, circuit electrodynamics, where you could probe the noise environment of a qubit to find out what makes the state decay. Moreover, we are working on formulas to analyze simultaneous weak measurements of 2 different operators. And even in biology, it might be useful, where telegraph-like blinking of fluorescence dye may be accompanied, that is, may be accompanied by a lot of noise, could still be analyzed via cumulants. And lastly, I wanted to announce that we are working on a Python package, which would allow you to do every analysis you saw in this talk, and of course more, in just a few lines of Python code. So stay tuned for that on GitHub. And that said, thank you very much for your attention, and I will be ready to take any question now.